I think the thing that scares new Linux users the most is the terminal. I think most new Linux users have this misconception that in order to use Linux as your daily desktop driver, that you have to be some sort of sysadmin or IT nerd, and that you basically have to live inside a terminal to get anything done in Linux. And that simply isn't the case. Nowadays, with so many user-friendly Linux distributions, such as Ubuntu, Linux Mint, Elementary, and dozens of others, you can happily run Linux and never need to open a terminal at all. But for power users and, you know, people that want to get more out of their Linux experience, learning the terminal, learning some basic commands and their usage is important. So this will be part one and what will probably be a long series of terminal commands and their usage. So let's get started. The first thing we're going to need to do in this terminal tutorial is, if you want to follow along with me and learn these commands, is you need to open up a terminal on your desktop. So I have opened up a terminal here. I am using the Termite terminal. Termite, T-E-R-M-I-T-E is the name of this particular terminal emulator. But you can open up any terminal emulator you like. Every Linux distribution has Xterm installed on it. Xterm is X-T-E-R-M. If you're running a Linux distribution such as Ubuntu with Unity or any Linux distribution that has the GNOME desktop environment installed, you have the GNOME terminal on your machine. If you're running the KDE desktop environment, you have Console with a K installed. XFCE has the XFCE terminal. LXDE has the LXDE terminal. Any of them will function the same. So open up the terminal of your choice, and the first thing you will probably see is this squiggly character, this tilde character. And on most machines, you will also see somewhere, usually at the end after the tilde, on mine I've got it at the front, is this dollar sign. Now, what do these mean? Well, that tilde character is a shorthand way of writing our home directory. It is letting us know that we are currently inside our home directory. So my home directory, if I wrote out the full path to it, would be /home/Derek. Derek is my username. But we don't have to write /home/Derek. Tilde is just another way of writing the path to my home directory. So it's shorthand. It saves us on typing. The dollar sign that we mentioned earlier is just letting us know that we are at a shell prompt. This dollar sign also lets us know that we are logged in as a normal user, not a root user. If we log in as a root user instead of that dollar sign, we will usually see the pound sign. So now that we know what those two particular symbols mean, let's get started. First, the first terminal command I think we should discuss is the print working directory command, pwd. Basically, this command tells us where we are inside our directory. Now, we already see this tilde character here, so we are inside my home directory, but just to verify, pwd, hit enter, and it returns /home/Derek, my home directory. So, say we want to move from a directory other than my home directory. What is the command for that? Well, we need the change directory command, or the cd command. So, cd for change directory, and then the path to the directory you wish to change to. Say I want to change to my downloads directory. Well, tilde slash downloads, and as you can see, we have changed to my downloads directory. Now, I could have also typed out the full path to the downloads directory. As mentioned earlier, that tilde is shorthand for the full path to my home directory, home/home/Derek/downloads, would have done the exact same thing, but again, we don't have to type all that. The tilde character basically saves us on typing. Say I want to move to my root directory. CD slash for root. And as you can see, the prompt lets me know that I am in fact in my root directory now. I also have this little lock icon on mine letting me know that I don't have privileges inside that directory because I'm logged in as my normal user, the Derek user. I'm not logged in as root. So, well, let's get out of the root directory because we're really not going to do much in it today. Certainly not in this tutorial. So let me move back to my home directory. How would I do that? Well, there's several ways to get back to the home directory. First, I could CD and then type the path to my home directory, slash home, slash Derek. That gets me there. Of course, we mentioned earlier that the tilde character is the same as writing the full path to my home directory, so CD space tilde gets me there. But by default, CD and no other argument added to it also takes you to the home directory. The next command we should learn is the list command. The list command is one of the most important terminal commands you'll use. I use it constantly. Basically, the list command is ls, and what this does is it lists the contents of a particular directory. If no other arguments are presented, the list command will list all the contents of the directory we're currently in, which in this case I'm in my home directory. So ls, hit enter, and there you go, it returns to the contents of my home directory. All of the contents of my home directory? Well, not exactly. In Linux, you have what are known as hidden directories and hidden files. Those are the ones that begin with a period at the beginning of their name, and they're called hidden files. And by default, hidden files do not appear when you run the list command. You can make them appear, though, by giving the list command a flag. So type in ls space dash a. This is the a flag. It stands for all. Click enter, and now it lists all the files and directories inside my home directory, including the hidden ones, which are the ones, again, that start with a period. You will also notice some weird highlighting on some of these files and folders. You see this strange green highlighting that almost makes it impossible to read the file name. Just ignore that for now. That is a safety feature in Linux. It's letting me know that I should fix the permissions of those files and folders, that currently they're writable to all, and that's dangerous to have files and directories that are writable to everybody. Especially if this was a server. Now, this isn't a server, this is my desktop, so it's not that big of a deal, but I probably should fix those permissions on those files and folders, but we'll ignore that for now. We'll have a video on file permissions at a later date. Back to the list command. So we have list, just ls, and then we have ls-a, for list all. That includes all the hidden files and directories. What other flags could we give list? Well, ls-l is what is known as the long format of listing. Basically, instead of just giving us a list of the files and directory names, it gives us the permissions, it gives us the user, the group, file size, date, it gives us more information than just simply a list of file names. You can combine flags on terminal commands. So if I wanted to, say, have the long form listing, I could ls-l for long, and say I wanted to also list all the hidden files and directories, I could also do a -a. And now I get the long form listing of all the files and directories inside my home directory. Could save on typing instead of doing ls-l and then a -a. You could just combine that to la, and it returns the same list. What other flags are possible with the list command? Well, there's a lot of them, and I don't know them offhand, so how would I go about looking up all the flags that I could use with the list command. Well, in Linux, we have what are known as manpages. Manpages are manual pages. They're basically instruction manuals. And almost every program in Linux will have a manpage. How do you view the manpage? Well, in a terminal, you type man, the name of the program. So, if we want to look up the manpage for the list function, man ls, hit enter, and this is the man page for ls. As you can see, it lists a bunch of flags that you could use. Here was one we used early on, was the dash a, the all flag. We had used the l flag for the long listing format. Another one we could have used would be something like dash R for recursive, dash S for size, which prints the allocated size of each file in blocks. So you got a few options here. One I like is, if I can find it in the list here, is dash H, lowercase h. For human readable, what this does is, let me get out of the man page, Q to get out of man pages. It tells you at the bottom of the screen, but anytime you need to leave a man page, hit Q for quit, and you're back to the prompt. When I do the long format listing of list, you will notice it gives me the size of the files. Well, for very large files, say this CCAT file here or this JAR file here, you know, they're presented in bytes. Those are very big numbers. You know, it's kind of hard to judge. I mean, is that 2 million bytes? Is that 20 million bytes? It would be better if, you know, we converted some of these large numbers to kilobytes or megabytes or gigabytes. So, with that H flag, you can ls-l for long format listing. Also, now add the H flag, and voila, we've converted those, you know, kind of unreadable byte numbers to more readable kilobytes and megabytes. So, back to man pages. Again, man program. It's one of the most important things you will learn in Linux is the man pages. Anytime you have a question or a concern about a program, just refer to the man page. That's what it's there for. Are there any other ways we could get help information for a command? Well, sure. Most commands will also have a help flag that you can invoke. For example, the ls command has a help flag, ls, and then space, dash, dash, the word help. Also returns, you know, some information. Actually, it looks like it returns basically this exact same information that was in the man page. So, most commands will have a help flag, you know, dash dash help, that you can type to get quick information. Or, like I said, almost every program in Linux has a man page. Very few programs don't have a man page. Matter of fact, I can think of one right off the top of my head we discussed already, I know for certain does not have a man page, and that was the cd command we used earlier. So man cd returns nothing, no manual entry for cd. But I can understand why cd doesn't have a man page. I mean, it essentially does one function, it changes the directory. So is a man page really needed for it? Probably not.